Okay, so now we're ready to tackle the grand picture of the evolution of metabolism. And this will involve looking at photosynthesis, even though we haven't yet covered those biochemical pathways. We will shortly, but after next week. But right now, let's tackle, look at the evolution of metabolism. So here's a hypothetical timeline that incorporates fossil evidence as well as molecular homologies of biochemical pathways. So the first great advance in the biochemical pathways of catabolism was the ability to store energy in ATP. And the source of that chemical energy were organic molecules, the energy stored in the chemical bonds of organic molecules that were present abiotically. Those organic molecules weren't produced by other life forms. They were just present in the early organic soups, the primeval soups that existed early in Earth's existence. And then the evolution of glycolysis was clearly a major advance in metabolism. And again, the earliest organisms were probably using glycolysis to produce ATP, but using the organic molecules that were already present in the soups, the organic soups early in life. And the evolution of the glycolytic pathway, of course, must have involved, had to involve enzymes, that is the production of protein. So we're already quite advanced in the ability to encode information and decode information in the form of proteins. We have the proteins that run glycolysis. So glycolysis was clearly a very early advance in life's evolution because glycolysis is shared by virtually all life forms today. So this was a very early innovation, and although we look at it as being very as rather non-efficient compared to, let's say, aerobic respiration, nevertheless, it must have been a great advance to be able to produce ATP through the glycolytic pathway. And the next huge advance was the evolution of photosynthesis, that is, the evolution of auxotrophy. Auxotrophs don't need they don't need to feed on other organisms or other organic molecules even. They can make their own food using the light energy derived from the sun. And the earliest photosynthetic organisms did not use water as modern plants do, or as later plants did, or even later bacteria did. They did this anaerobically, and they did not produce oxygen like oxygenic photosynthesis organisms do. They produced free sulfur, and they used as electron donors hydrogen sulfide. And here's an example of present day. There are still present day bacteria. These are filamentous bacteria from the sulfide hot springs, the sulfur hot springs in Yellowstone National Park. And they use H2S, and they evolve sulfur as a in the photosynthetic process. So there's evidence for these very early bacteria being present over 2 billion years ago. Then huge advance was to be able to use water in photosynthesis. And the cyanobacteria were about 2 billion years ago. We have fossil evidence that indicates cyanobacteria were present, and we know that cyanobacteria use water as an electron donor for photosynthesis, and they capture light energy, and in the process, they evolve oxygens. They produce gaseous oxygen. And that oxygen, the early Earth's atmosphere was almost oxygen free. The only oxygen that existed was in water. But with the evolution of photosynthetic organisms that used water as an electron donor, the production of oxygen ensued, and that basically increased the oxygen in the atmosphere over billions of years to 20% of the atmosphere. So oxygen is about 20% of the current Earth's atmosphere. And that oxygen was probably initially toxic to organisms, but organisms later then could evolve a way to use that oxygen in catabolism, in respiration. And that was a huge advance. Organisms that could do that. So the early early bacteria that were able to evolve oxidative phosphorylation and using oxygen as an electron acceptor at the end of of the electron transport chain. Those organisms had a huge advantage in that they derived much energy that could be used to drive ATP synthesis. So these are present-day cyanobacteria, but we know that there were ancient cyanobacteria that evolved this ability at least 2 billion years ago. And then the evolution of nitrogen fixation ensued, and that was a huge advance because, as you know, proteins have nitrogen in them, as do nucleic acids in the nitrogenous bases of nucleic acids. But photosynthesis can't produce those compounds that are used in the production of proteins and nucleic acids because those compounds contain nitrogen, and photosynthesis only produces carbohydrates. So the ability to fix nitrogen was a huge advance. That is, the ability to take nitrogen gas present in the atmosphere and fix that and use that and utilize that to build molecules was huge. And this is an example of present-day nitrogen-fixing organisms. This is a root nodule of a plant, in the root of a plant, and these are nitrogen-fixing bacteria, the rhizobia bacteria. Rhizobium is the name of the bacterium. And oxygen, the evolution of nitrogen fixation had to evolve before oxygen produced by photosynthetic organisms, by oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, greatly increased the oxygen in the atmosphere because oxygen is toxic to the processes, to the biochemistry of nitrogen fixation. And today we see nitrogen-fixing organisms only in oxygen-free environments, or alternatively, these rhizobia have compartments within them that are oxygen-free that they use to fix nitrogen. And these type of bacteria live symbiotically with plants that can't fix their own nitrogen, and they use these bacteria to do so. These bacteria greatly enhance the plant's ability to reproduce because they're providing nitrogen for those plants, and those plants usually live in nitrogen-poor environments. So that was a huge advance, the evolution of nitrogen fixation. And finally, we get to the evolution of aerobic respiration. Once the oxygenic photosynthetic organisms had produced enough oxygen, there was tremendous selection pressure to use that oxygen in a productive way. Initially, the oxygen was probably toxic to organisms, but those bacteria that evolved a way to use oxygen as a final electron acceptor in the electron transport chain had a huge advantage, and because they produce lots of ATP, as we know, through aerobic respiration, using oxygen as that final electron acceptor in the electron transport chain. And so when we look at the grand picture of evolution of metabolism, we see that biochemical pathways involved in metabolism evolved one on top of another slowly over billions of years, and that if we look at this and this, if we look at this biochemistry from an evolutionary perspective, we understand why things have the property, why metabolism has the property it does. If you were to start from scratch, and if you were an intelligent designer, let's say, and you wanted to design a biochemical pathway for the oxidation of glucose, you probably wouldn't include a glycolytic step because you really don't get much energy out of that. You might instead choose to go straight into pyruvate production or Krebs cycle, but that's not how evolution works. Evolution works by the building upon pre-existing biochemistry. So new pathways evolve upon the foundations laid by other pathways. And we know that that evolution of glycolysis was a very early step. Glycolysis is shared by virtually all life forms on Earth today, so it was present very early. And that was built upon till we finally get aerobic respiration as the most recent addition to the repertoire of catalytic pathways that can be used to derive energy. And now we're ready to tackle the oxygenic photosynthesis that all plants and algae and even some bacteria use today. And we're going to look at those biochemical pathways that are anabolic, that allow plants to fix carbon from carbon dioxide in the atmosphere to produce carbohydrates. Now, if we look at the biochemical reactions of glucose oxidation that we've considered, we have glucose C6H12O6 plus six molecular oxygens, and that yields what? It yields six carbon dioxides, six CO2s come out of that, six waters come out of that. So when we burn glucose aerobically, we produce as waste, in a way, carbon dioxide. We breathe out carbon dioxide and we breathe out water. And what do we get out of that? We get energy plus energy in the form of ATP. And photosynthesis, in a way, is the opposite of this process. So this might be then respiration. And we know that photosynthesis goes the other way. So we'll just say PS for photosynthesis. And photosynthesis takes energy in the form of light energy. So this could be down here, we'd say light energy plus water plus carbon dioxide yields oxygen, six molecules of molecular oxygen, plus sugars like glucose. So in a way, photosynthesis is the opposite of respiration. And as we've just talked about, photosynthesis evolved prior to the full respiratory pathway. And we're going to see in photosynthesis some of the same molecules that were present in the respiratory pathways, the late respiratory pathways. So we will see that for example, electron carriers in electron transport chains evolved in photosynthetic organisms, in oxygenic photosynthetic organisms, and then these were derived and utilized to evolve respiratory pathways later on. We're also going to see that both respiration and photosynthesis use the key enzyme complex ATP synthase. And this will be very interesting to see how photosynthesis uses ATP synthase in kind of a reverse manner to the way that ATP synthase is used in respiration. So that's where we're going to go when we tackle photosynthesis in a few days. So that's the end of our treatment of glycolysis and respiration and the evolution of metabolism.